Hi everyone, welcome to this lecture on electric cars and their challenges for public policymakers. Today we will have a look at electric vehicles in an infrastructure systems perspective. As we have seen, electric vehicles offer a lot of benefit for a society that wants to retain mobility in a decarbonized future. An electric vehicle, however, cannot be compared with a coffee machine that you can easily replace with another coffee machine without any further ado. Electric vehicles do not only require drivers to adopt new routines, they also have many consequences for many of the infrastructure systems that society and the economy rely on, most notably the transport and energy infrastructure systems. These systems have evolved over decades, even centuries, and have consequently become deeply embedded in the economic and social structure. Therefore, we will have a closer look at the characteristics of the infrastructure systems which are affected by electric vehicles. We need a theoretical framework to structure our analysis of how electric vehicles interfere with the established infrastructure, and that helps us to design effective interventions. So, let me introduce you today to the world of complex adaptive systems. And as an example, I will use the electricity infrastructure. The first true electricity infrastructure came online in 1882. It consisted of a single coal-fired generator providing power to the light bulbs of 59 customers within a New York neighborhood. Soon, similar systems sprouted in major cities around the world. Eventually, these systems were expanded to link entire urban areas with a diversity of electrical devices and multiple generators operating simultaneously. Gradually, these isolated grids were linked to provide backup power and improve stability. They were extended to connect progressively larger and more remote power generation facilities. And in today's electricity infrastructure, these formerly separate networks have been linked into national and even transnational continental power systems. Throughout the history of the electricity infrastructure, technologies have changed. The technology of power generation changed from small-scale generators to massive coal and gas-fired power plants, to nuclear power plants and large-scale hydropower installations. At this point in time, the dominant position of fossil fuels in the electricity system is no longer taken for granted, as we are concerned about long-term energy security, global warming, and about the heavy toll of fossil fuels on the natural environment and public health. All of these concerns make us move in the direction of renewable energy sources. Among these, biomass is quite controversial, as some energy crops have caused large-scale destruction of rainforests and led to displacement of indigenous communities and small farmers. But moreover, biofuel combustion, whether it is in power generation plants or in cars, still leads to air pollution. So emission-free renewable energy technologies, especially solar and wind power, have thus gained in popularity. Most of the technologies for harvesting solar and wind energy are characterized by a relatively small scale, which implies that more and more decentralized electricity production is being developed, not only by established players in the energy market, but also by farmers, citizen cooperatives, and even individual homeowners. With solar panels on their roofs, even city dwellers can become prosumers, which do not only consume, but also produce electricity. Now, what do we learn from this short history lesson? The first key lesson is that electricity infrastructure was not designed as the integrated system that we know today. Rather than being designed, it evolved into an integrated large-scale system, constantly adapting to changing societal preferences and user needs, to changing economic conditions, and to the emergence of new technologies. But how then, you may ask, can a large-scale technological system adapt? And this is where the social dimension of the infrastructure kicks in, which I will illustrate shortly to convey the second key lesson, which is that the complex adaptive behavior of infrastructure systems is better understood if we recognize infrastructure systems as socio-technical systems. An infrastructure is more than a physical network connecting generators and loads. It is a system that connects millions of users with a multitude of producers, and that involves system operators, market operators, regulatory authorities, and so on. The system can adapt through the decisions of these social actors, for example, in fixing technical standards, and in the decision-making about capital investments and disinvestments, or through changing user behavior. An important actor in the electricity system, as it is in the transport and mobility infrastructure system, is government. Throughout most of the 20th century, the key tasks of electricity generation, transmission, distribution, and supply were concentrated within one single organization per country, a so-called vertically integrated utility. And in many countries, this single organization was a public monopoly. And in the case of a private monopoly, it was at least heavily regulated by the government to safeguard the affordability and reliability of service, but also safety and other relevant public values. In recent decades, however, processes of infrastructure reform have induced so-called vertical unbundling of the electricity value chain. In many countries, power generation has largely been privatized and now takes place in a competitive market. Similarly, energy wholesale and even retail markets have in many countries been opened up to competition. And with these markets, new players have entered the scene, such as market operators, traders, and brokers. And in between power generation and supply to end users is the transport over grids. And these grids are still owned, operated, and planned by monopolistic system operators. They are known as TSOs, transmission system operators, and DSOs, distribution system operators. As you can see, the social system of the electricity infrastructure has thus become much more complex. And the complexity of the social network is still increasing as private end users are turning into prosumers and electric vehicles are entering the scene with the potential of providing a range of innovative services to the electricity infrastructure. While electric vehicles offer promising solutions to the challenge of accommodating the variability of renewable energy sources, they can also endanger the stability of the grid. To make sure that does not happen, new practices and rules are needed. And this brings us to the crucial feature of institutions in infrastructure systems. The interactions between the social and the technical dimension of infrastructure systems are shaped and governed through institutions at different levels with different timescales. At the highest level, institutions are the social norms and public values that we adhere to. Institutions define the rules of the game, and institutions define how the game is played, including how resources are allocated. In other words, the roles and responsibilities of actors in the infrastructure system are defined by institutions. While higher level institutions define, for example, market rules and regulatory authority, lower level institutions define contracts, technical and operational standards. So where are we now? The conceptual model I have provided you with is the model of complex adaptive socio-technical systems. A complex network of actors, the social system, in constant interaction with a complex physical network, the technical system, with the interactions between the social and the technical systems shaped and governed by institutions. Both the physical system and the social system are constantly adapting and co-evolving. A complex system, like electricity or transport infrastructure, cannot just be redesigned overnight. It is characterized by so-called path dependencies, which are reinforced by the high capital intensity and long lifespan of infrastructure components. Another characteristic of complex adaptive systems is that their behavior cannot be predicted. It emerges from the interactions between the actors and between the subsystems. The non-linearities caused by feedbacks between actors and subsystems across system levels and timescales are the main cause of the so-called emergent behavior of complex adaptive systems. Fortunately, the emergent behavior of infrastructure systems shows remarkably consistent patterns. Even if I do not come home at exactly the same time every day, and even though my individual use of electric devices in my home differs from day to day, the aggregated pattern of road congestion and electricity demand during the day is very similar, with slight variations between working days and weekends and with seasonal variations. However, this feature of emergent behavior implies that we cannot really predict how the system will behave with the introduction of a new technology. This and the feature of path dependency also imply that government has, in fact, only limited steering power. Government can only aspire to steer the ongoing evolutionary process into the direction dictated by new societal preferences, by tweaking the institutional framework. Now, you may be disappointed by this muddy picture if you had expected a clear recipe of how to design new institutions for the introduction of electric vehicles. However, while the options for government intervention may be limited, they are crucial nevertheless, among others in the setting of standards and the design of incentive schemes. Many national and local governments also have a crucial role as owners or major shareholders of a vital infrastructure. And perhaps most importantly, national governments have the prerogative to enshrine the roles and responsibilities of actors in law and regulation. Now, with this knowledge, let us get back to the matter at hand, the consequences of electric cars at the infrastructure level. Battery electric cars use electricity, obviously. For an average electric car driving in the Netherlands 30 kilometers on average per day, the annual electricity demand is of the same order of magnitude as the annual electricity demand of an average household, which is around 3,500 kilowatt hours in the Netherlands. So that implies that residential electricity use for an average household with just one car will be doubled if the conventional car is replaced with an electric car that is mostly recharged at home. Great news for the electricity suppliers, you might say, but perhaps not so great news for the network providers. They fear substantial congestion in the distribution grid if all drivers plug in as soon as they get home from the office, adding a substantial load to the usual peak load in the early evening. Congestion can be avoided by grid capacity expansion, which is rather expensive. A far cheaper solution is to control battery recharging according to available grid capacity and to the availability of cheap power. And if we follow the availability of cheap power, then that provides a financial incentive for the electric car owner to cooperate with a scheme for controlled charging, even if it does imply some infringement on the sovereignty and comfort of the car owner. In other words, the car owner is then rewarded for flexibility in his load pattern. The question that arises next is, how is this organized? Evidently, The electric car owner did not buy his vehicle with the aim to become an active participant in the electricity market. So how is this flexibility potential then mobilized? Through the network operator? Through the energy supplier? Or through a new intermediate party? And then what is the optimization criterion for controlled charging? You can imagine that the distribution network operator will strive to reduce network costs, while a commercial energy supplier will strive to maximize its profit. And what is the business model for the intermediate party, such as an aggregator? And what is the optimization criterion for the end user, as an electricity consumer and as a car owner? The answer to these questions depends on the divisions of roles and responsibilities in the electricity infrastructure system. As we have seen, the distribution network generally is a regulated monopoly, whereas energy suppliers and aggregators are operating in a competitive market. And the related question is, which actor should be installing and owning the public charging infrastructure? Some argue that this is a logical extension of the network operator's responsibilities, while others argue that charging infrastructure should evidently reside with the energy suppliers. While these questions are still unresolved in many countries, the answers are needed urgently. As you know, generation and load must be balanced at all times in the electricity system. And the system's need for flexibility in electricity demand is inevitably increasing with the increasing share of variable renewable energy sources in the generation mix. Deploying the demand flexibility of electric vehicles will involve real-time or close to real-time interaction with the end users, thus requiring a lot of smart IT support and telecommunication capacity. In other words, the flexibility of electric cars as smart components of the electricity system cannot be deployed without smart grids. So you see that the massive adoption of electric vehicles does not only affect the physical electricity system and the transport and mobility system, it also introduces a lot of digital technology and software dependencies into the physical infrastructure systems, involving new interactions between the transport and energy infrastructure systems. And besides the technical challenges implied, these changes also deeply affect the social dimension of the infrastructure. The established systems include a large number of actors which are involved as owners, planners, operators, etc., of the various physical components and subsystems of the infrastructure. And established actors with vested interests are likely to resist change which is not aligned with their own strategic agendas. So bringing a new technology such as electric cars into the system also brings new actors with new roles and interests and will require established actors to adapt, if not make their roles obsolete. And government plays an interesting role in this process, both as an established actor in critical infrastructure systems and as an enabler or agent of change. Later in this course, we will have interviews with government representatives at the local and national level and show you how different government interventions worked out in practical cases.